accurate QoD implementation of the boundary sign Gordon model? Please.
Now? Okay, better. Okay. Yes, thanks. Whereas we got so much used to the masks that they are almost fixed on the face, yeah. So thank you very much, the organizers, first of all, for the organization and invitation to this very nice meeting in the place that I like very much. It's always a pleasure to come back. Then, of course, I have to thank my collaborators. So it's a joint theory experiment work. So the experimental part, okay, pointer. Yeah, okay. So the main experimental work was done by Sébastien Léger, who was a PhD student at the Yale Institute. So two of his supervisors are here in the audience. The theory part was done by Teose Pülk, who was also a PhD student at Yale Institute with Serge Florence. There was also contribution from Isaac Snyman and myself. So Isaac is in Johannesburg, and I'm in a neighboring laboratory to the Yale Institute. I was looking for a nice picture in Grenoble, but I did not, so I had little time, and I just took the one that I had from my office window a few months ago. So that's kind of typical, yeah, randomly chosen, if you want. Not specially tuned, not specially selected. The outline, I will give first some motivation, which may be a little bit personal and kind of subjective. Then I will describe the experiment system, the experimental part. Hopefully, I will be able to do it correctly. If not, there is Nicolas and Olivier. Then I will discuss two theory aspects. There is, of course, a lot of overlap with the previous talk. So I will try to make connections. So motivation. You have already seen boundary sign Gordon model. So we have, this is the Lagrangian. This is basically an elastic string, semi-infinite in this case. And on the boundary, we have this cosine term. So this is called boundary sign Gordon. If you put this cosine inside the integral, then this is called bulk sign Gordon. I will be speaking mostly about boundary. This model is well known, it's integrable, and it has been solved exactly. So the question is, why should we bother studying it if everything is known about it? to my taste, this model, so this Lagrangian, if you take it literally, it's just a meaningless combination of letters, because this symbol J, you don't know what it is unless the model is supplied by a short distance cutoff. Then many things depend actually on the details of how this short distance cutoff is implemented. So it's better to say that this is not a model, but it's rather a class of equivalents of models. So you need always to start from some lattice model, which is well-defined at short distances. Then when you go to low energies and large distances, then you have universal physics that comes out. And this universal physics is somehow, can be somehow extracted from this boundary sign Gordon Lagrangian. But the problem is that first of all, there are phenomena that are not, that depend essentially on this cutoff, on this short distance physics. And even if you study phenomena which are supposed to become universal at this low energy scales, how to control the, so you have kind of asymptotic, so this exact solution or this integrability property that we heard about, they predict the asymptotic infrared behavior of the model. But how to control how well you are in this infrared limit? And this you cannot really do from the model. From the model itself. To control the theory, you always have to come back to the lattice model. And so to give some examples, so one example that we recently did, so we were studying the phase diagram of a Josephson junction chain, which, so this is just the very standard, let me show you the, so the very standard model for the Josephson junction chain without, so all junctions identical, Josephson energy, capacitance matrix, so the islands are coupled by the capacitance matrix, you have the two capacitances in the problem. So for this model, you can want to study phase diagram and, from if you think so this is supposed to be in the class of equivalence of bulk sine Gordon and so you have you know that there are two phases superconducting phase insulating phase you know that the transition is Kosterlitz belongs to Kosterlitz Tauless universality class you have scaling that is known since many years. But if you try to establish, to guess the phase diagram looking at this universal scaling, trying to see which of the parameters of the lattice model are renormalized in which way, then you would not guess the correct form. So what we found is that this boundary is determined by some much more stupid and dumb short-range effects then the which dominate over the Kosterlitz-Tauless scaling. even more spectacular example is this recent story about Schmidt transition. So what you guess from this universal scaling laws is this kind of phase diagram. So you have dimensionless resistance and the ratio EJ to EC. So from the scaling, you would guess that your boundary between the two phases would be vertical. And so the experiment was done, which was supposed to be in, according to this phase diagram, in the insulating state. They did not find the insulating state. So they started to suspect that there is no phase transition at all. But in fact, if you take this model and you simulate taking into account all short distance effects, then, oops, sorry. The phase diagram actually looks quite different. So this is again beyond this usual asymptotic scaling that you would get from the effective field theory. And you see that the insulator phase is actually much more much more narrow than what you would think. Okay, so this is my motivation. So the when you want to study something that some lattice model that boils down to a quantum field theory in the infrared limit, then to control this infrared limit is not so easy. You cannot really control it based only on the quantum field theory. okay, so now I go to the main topic. So this is the experimental system and it's very, very similar to what we saw from the previous talk. So there is a Josephson junction chain and in this part, so there is like 400 junctions which are large enough. So the cosine, the Josephson cosine, you can expand into up to quadratic order, and then you get just a harmonic chain which you can think of transmission line, which hosts linear modes. So here, there is our boundary impurity, which is a squid, so that you can control the Josephson. So this remains a cosine, and the coefficient in front of this cosine you can control by external magnetic field. Then you do, on the left side, you have the external circuit where you send microwaves and you can measure their transmission. So this, the Hamiltonian of this is, so if we just think about the chain and the boundary, just this part, it's the harmonic part for the chain. So this small junction also has some capacitance, and this capacitance goes into the harmonic part of the Hamiltonian. And we have the boundary, the cosine at the boundary. Yeah, sorry for the pointer. I'm still, I have to adjust to the speed of it. Maybe, I don't know if I stand here, maybe it's better. Yeah, slightly better. Okay, yeah. So the typical result from a measurement is this. So you measure, so you send photons into your transmission line. So you send incoming photon here, you collect them here. So the transmission coefficient typically as a function of frequency has a form with some sharp dips. And each dip is corresponds to a standing wave in the chain. And when you tune your flux through the squid, through the small squid, you change the positions of these dips and also the widths. And you can think of this as so flux modifies this Josephson energy, which is standing here, and this modifies the modes of the chain. And this is how you measure this. So first of all, how are these modes made? So if we take an infinite chain, this harmonic Hamiltonian that I wrote on the previous slide, and just look for the linear modes, which are plane waves, then we have a certain dispersion, which is linear only here at low frequencies. And then it deviates and saturates. So there is a natural cutoff in this lattice model, which is called plasma frequency, which is 18 gigahertz here. So this, and when you take the experimental these experimental dips and you put them you just put them on your plot as a function of the wave number, you have this these dots and you can fit the dispersion relation and you get all the parameters of your chain. So if you want to see how they are spaced, how is the quantization condition for the standing wave, then you have to look at the boundary conditions of the at the ends of your chain. So on the left, we have this transmission line, 50 ohm, and this is almost grounded. On the right, we have this element, small junction, and in the very first approximation, you can think, okay, let us take it also quadratic, expand this cosine. Then we have something, some effective boundary condition, which is sensitive to the flux. And this boundary condition introduces a phase shift, scattering phase shift. And then this determines the positions of the modes. And by measuring how the positions depend on the flux, you can extract this phase shift and see how it behaves on the frequency. So this is the plot of the scattering phase shift as a function of frequency for different fluxes. So what does it tell us? The most important qualitative feature of these curves is that they are very smooth. And this means one thing. Here, at the end, you can think about a of this small junction. So we already heard in the previous talks yesterday that you can it can be a qubit, or you can think of it as a harmonic oscillator or a weakly harmonic oscillator, transmon, something that has its own energy levels. And then if you if it has well-defined energy levels, then it would produce resonances for the modes of the chain. If you have well-defined resonances, then your scattering phase shift varies very sharply when your frequency goes through the resonance. So the smooth nature of these curves tells us that there is basically no resonance, that the it's completely overdamped by the strong coupling to the modes of the chain. And this is where it is, where this system is different from the works that the previous speaker discussed. So in particular, the experiment in Manoucherian's group. So and then this means that this system is indeed more similar to the boundary sine Gordon, where you have just the cosine. You don't have any internal dynamics associated to your boundary. All the dynamics is in the chain, and you just have this nonlinear cosine at the boundary. Okay, so scattering shifts that we can, so now I will move more to theoretical part. So the first thing to understand and to model is this scattering phase shift, which depends on the frequency and depends on the flux. So if we just take, as I said, replace this nonlinear element by something effectively linear, then of course the phase shifts you can calculate exactly, but this is not this will not correspond to the experimental result. The effect of the nonlinearity in the very first approximation, you can think of effective renormalization of your cosine by vacuum fluctuations. So basically, this tells you that your EJ becomes renormalized. That we call EJ star, renormalized by the vacuum fluctuations, which is, well, this kind of factor, you see it like Debye-Waller factor. This is all comes from the same physics, renormalization by your harmonic environment. So you can put this this procedure into a self-consistent into a self-consistent scheme, then it's called self-consistent harmonic approximation. So basically, this delta phi square, you evaluate this by taking your by putting your linear element as some effective inductance that is not exactly the bare one. This is known since long ago, this procedure, and you can view this as self-consistent dressing of your self-energy, or you can view it as the best variational wave function from the Gaussian family, from which you minimize the energy of the system. So the result is not bad. So you see that the effect is strong enough. We have a factor of so this the dashed line is the bare EJ that you would just guess from the squid from the Aronoff-Bohm prefactor. This is the actual EJ star that you extract from the positions of the peaks translated into phase shifts translated into EJ star. So this is the dots are the experimental curves. So we have this magenta line is the self-consistent harmonic approximation, which breaks down at some point when EJ becomes too small. The dotted line is the universal scaling that you get from the boundary sign Gordon. So our alpha here is 0.3, so we are on the superconducting side of, superconducting side of the Schmidt transition. So here you see the behavior of the experiment, of the experimental points, it goes quite well with this universal boundary sign Gordon scaling. Breaks down at some low frequencies, low energies because of the finite temperature. And the scaling is, of course, a zero temperature result. And at high energies, it deviates because we have cutoff. So the theory, you really start feeling lattice effects. And this self-consistent harmonic approximation, of course, takes care of all the lattice effects correctly. More interesting is the decay. So this is precisely the topic of the previous talk. So you see we have as a function of flux and frequency, the quality factor of the modes changes. And this is the photon down conversion, which, okay, so I don't have to explain what it is because the previous speaker did a very good job at this. So how to model this? So here we want to take into account these lattice effects and to implement the ultraviolet cutoff as it is. So what do we do? So first of all, so here we introduce the Green's function of the phase, so phase-phase correlator. The transmission coefficient into this in this transmission line, you can relate it exactly to the Green's function. So the Green's function satisfies the Dyson equation. In this Dyson equation here, everything is harmonic. So C and L minus 1 are the capacitance and inverse inductance matrices of this whole thing. So this is the damping introduced by the transmission line on this side. And all the effect of the nonlinearity is sitting here in this self-energy, which is located only on this last side. So this, if we have the self-energy, then we have this equation for the Green's function. So the whole interesting physics is in the self-energy. So what do we do with the self-energy? So we do, we do a perturbative calculation in the Josephson. This is because our the most interesting, the strongest effect you see is near half flux, near half flux quantum where the Josephson is suppressed. 5 minutes. Yeah, thank you. So. No, not this direction. Sorry. So we do perturbative. We have a perturbative expression for the self energy up to the up to second order. So this takes into account. You see, it still takes into account inelastic processes to so all multi-photon production, not just 1 to 3, but also 1 to 5, 1 to 7. But to perturbatively in Josephson. This is controlled at high frequencies. If the frequency is higher than EJ star, this is what the previous speaker also mentioned. So we are on this high frequency side. It can be easily generalized to finite temperatures, and this is what we actually do. So here I wrote the zero temperature version, but you can put Keldysh and put the finite temperature. So we do self-consistently, again, it's a self-consistent Born approximation because this Green's function is the one that should be determined from this equation. And this defines the self-consistency loop. So it captures a lot of useful effects. So when you do it on the self-consistent level, you take into account the fact that the photons into which you decay, they are not the bare photons, but they themselves are dressed and they themselves decay. So you have this hierarchy of multi-photon cascades. This is important because we have a finite chain and the level discreteness matters. The mode discreteness matters in this chain. So with this, you can also describe many-body localization or delocalization. So in our case, it's delocalization because the peaks that we observe are smooth Lorentzian peaks in the transmission. What this approximation misses, it misses the quantum phase slips because it's perturbative in EJ, so you do not go to the next minimum of the cosine. So this the result for the flux, near flux quantum, which is in the, so this is the parameter which controls. So when we are within this applicability regime, it's fine. Our theory fits the experiment reasonably well. You see that this decay, the frequency dependence is rather exponential because we have linear scale here and logarithmic here, and is not at all the power law that you would expect from the boundary sign Gordon infrared asymptotics. So this is a success. If you try to go to fluxes which are smaller than, significantly smaller than half flux quantum, then you are out of the regime of applicability, and then this self-consistent Born second order, it miserably fails. You see there is, Serge and Theo, they even tried to push it to the third order, but once your second order breaks, once the leading order breaks, you usually need all orders. So the third order pulls you in the good direction, but does not cure the situation. And in this regime, I think we don't have any reliable theory available which would account both for the lattice effects and for the all non-perturbative stuff. And this is all I wanted to tell you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, the talk is open to discussion.
Thank you very much. So just to make sure I understand, so you're claiming that what leads to the different dependence of the decay rate makes it exponential, not a power law, is the dressing of the photons, or what is the reason that you get this deviation?
You mean this exponential instead of power law?
Yeah.
This is bad separation of scales, EJ star and ultraviolet cutoff. We are still not in the scaling regime infrared asymptotics.
Let's see. So what you need to get in this regime is, I guess, longer chains or?
Longer chains and lower frequencies. And I don't know which one is more constraint for experimentalists.
Both.
Both. Any other questions, comments? No, then I would propose we thank the speaker.
Thank you very much.